It is September 8, 1960, dedication day for the George C. Marshall Space Flight Center. The Marshall Center, located at Huntsville, Alabama, is the newest and largest installation of the National Aeronautics and Space Administration. Guests who will participate in the dedication ceremonies arrive at Redstone Airfield. Alabama Governor John Patterson, Marshall Center Director Dr. Wernher von Braun, and representatives for the Army Ordnance Missile Command wait to greet the official visitors. Congressional guests, NASA officials, and other Washington visitors are the first to arrive. Many of these guests are making their first trip to Huntsville, indicating the national significance of the Marshall Center and its more than 5,000 employees. The center occupies 1,200 acres nearby the city of Huntsville. Its unique facilities are valued at about $100 million. Both the facilities and a majority of the employees were transferred to NASA from the U.S. Army at the direction of the President. The center formally opened on July 1, 1960. The new center is in charge of developing NASA's deep space launch vehicles and conducting related research. Visitors and guests now board a bus, which will join the official motorcade to the dedication site. Aboard the presidential aircraft, the Columbine, is President Dwight D. Eisenhower, here to make the formal dedication of the Marshall Space Flight Center. The president's unprecedented trip to Huntsville on this day reflects the future importance of the Marshall Center in this country's space program. First to greet the president are Dr. von Braun, Governor Patterson, Colonel O.T. McCloskey, Major General August Schomburg, and other distinguished guests. And members of the official party join the motorcade, which will make the short trip to the Marshall Center headquarters. A crowd estimated at about 10,000 Marshall Center and Arsenal employees is waiting to view the president and to take part in the dedication ceremonies.
I'd like to introduce to you Dr. Harry C. Wade, minister of the First Presbyterian Church of Huntsville, who will give the invocation.
Let us pray. Our Father, we are grateful for the privilege of remembering and honoring a man like General George C. Marshall. We're grateful that thou didst endow him with those qualities of courage and vision and leadership which enabled him to serve his country so well, both in the days of war when the fighting was with guns, and in the days thereafter when the struggle was with words, ideologies, and thought patterns of life. His service, both as a soldier and as a statesman, is a challenge to all of us. We pray very humbly that this installation, declared this day a memorial to him, may so stand in the years ahead as a continuing testimony of a grateful people. We pray very humbly that thou wilt continue to raise up men of stature who shall be able to lead on and out in the crises which come ever and again in both our national and our international life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Mr. President, Mrs. Marshall, distinguished guests, it is with humble pride and the very deepest feeling that I welcome you to the George C. Marshall Space Flight Center. It is most fitting indeed that we have gathered here today to honor in such splendid fashion one of our truly great Americans, the revered and respected George C. Marshall. We of the George C. Marshall Space Flight Center are deeply gratified to share with you this opportunity to pay further homage to this man, his name, and his deeds. I should like now to introduce to you the governor of the great state of Alabama, the Honorable John Patterson. Governor Patterson.
Mr. President, Mrs. Marshall, Dr. Von Braun, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. As governor, it is a great pleasure to extend official greetings of the state of Alabama to our distinguished visitors, notably the President of the United States. We are delighted to have you visit us again, Mr. President, and we offer to you and your party a warm welcome. We are also deeply honored to have Mrs. Marshall and Dr. Glennon here with us today. Your presence adds to the significance of this occasion. We are extremely pleased to have both of you in the state of Alabama. I wish to extend to all the members of the official party the best wishes of our citizens. On behalf of the state of Alabama, I welcome you to our state and assure you of our warm, sincere hospitality. We in Alabama are very proud of this splendid federal installation. It means more jobs for our people, more money for our economy. By virtue of its payroll, this base happens to be the largest single employer, public or private, in our state. Due to the economic impact of Redstone Arsenal, the city of Huntsville more than tripled in population in the last 10 years. It is now Alabama's fourth largest city, a thriving community of 72,000 citizens, and it proudly boasts of its slogan, Rocket City, USA. But more than this, we as Americans are gratified at the outstanding work being performed here in the national interest. We are elated to know of the amazing scientific advances in our missile program, which have already taken place here at Redstone. And now we watch with the entire free world the development of the Saturn space project right here at Redstone. I wish to commend Dr. Von Braun and his staff for their long string of scientific accomplishments for our country. They have done a great job working as a team under the guidance of the U.S. Army. Now, as their research and development facilities are formally transferred to the National Space and Aeronautics Administration, I know I join with free peoples everywhere in wishing them good fortune and good luck. I hope that their discoveries and breakthroughs as members of the George C. Marshall Space Flight Center will be even more notable and will help in their way to keep peace in our world. Mr. President, we are delighted that you are visiting us. I wish to thank you for being here today, and I invite you, Dr. Glennon, Mrs. Marshall, and the rest of our guests to come back to visit with us again in the very near future. Thank you very much.
Now I should like to introduce to you some of our many distinguished guests. Were I to introduce all of them, we would be here all day. I'd like each guest to stand until all have been introduced. On my left is Senator Wiley of Wisconsin. To my right, Representative Emilio Q. Daddario, Connecticut. To my left, Representative Carl Elliott of Alabama. To my left, Representative Joe L. Evans of Tennessee. Also to my left, Representative James G. Fulton of Pennsylvania. To my left, Representative Robert E. Jones, Jr. of Alabama. To my right, Representative Albert Waynes of Alabama. To my left, Representative R. Walter Wheelman, New York. Also to my left, Mr. Louis G. Odom, Jr., representing Senator Sparkman, who is detained by a Senate Foreign Relations Committee meeting today in Washington. To my left, Dr. G. B. Kistiakowski, the President's Scientific Advisor. To my right, Mr. Robert Moore, Jr. To my left, the Honorable Hugh Milton, Undersecretary of the Army. To my right, General L. L. Lemnitzer, Chief of Staff, United States Army. To my left, Lieutenant General Herbert B. Powell, Commanding General, 3rd Army, Atlanta. To my left, Major General August Schomburg, Commanding General of the Army, Ordnance Missile Command. To my right, Colonel Owen T. McCloskey, Commander of Redstone Arsenal. Also to my right, Major General H. N. Tolstoy, United States Army, retired. As all of you know, General Tolstoy was our past commander. He was also the man who brought me and some of my colleagues to this country some 15 years ago. To my left, Mayor R.B. Beck Searcy, our one and only mayor of Huntsville. Left, Colonel James J. Wynn, United States Army, retired. Also to my left, Miss Aline W. Wynn, granddaughter of Miss Marshall. And now I should like to present to you the Honorable T. Keith Glennon, Administrator of the National Aeronautics and Space Administration.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States. Governor Patterson, Mrs. Marshall, Mayor Searcy, Dr. Glennon, Dr. Von Braun, members of the Congress here present, other distinguished guests, and my fellow Americans, all of you. It is always good to come back to our Southland, this region of traditional hospitality and friendliness. I thank you, Governor, for making me feel so much at home and so welcome in your state. I have long looked forward to visiting this spot. I know that for an old foot soldier, it will be a revelation to see firsthand the effort here underway to probe into the mysteries of the universe millions of miles from our Earth. Already, in brief visits with your distinguished men of rocketry, I have made a significant discovery of my own. I find that the leaders of the new space science feel as if Venus and Mars are more accessible to them than a regimental headquarters was to me more than 40 years ago when I was a platoon commander. To move conceptually in one generation from the hundreds of yards that once bounded my tactical world to the unending millions of miles that beckon these men forward is a transformation. Now, I freely admit to sentimentality in my contemplation of these advances, because so much of this dramatic accomplishment was pioneered in the United States Army, which until recently was my home and my life. Here under Army guidance, Redstone and Jupiter and a whole family of missiles have taken form. Here too was created Explorer 1, America's first Earth satellite. I share with the Army its gratification in these trailblazing achievements, which have their counterparts in other services. These achievements have thrilled the American people and won plaudits throughout the world. The momentum thus gained accelerates today under the civilian management of the new National Aeronautics and Space Administration, guided by Dr. Glennon and his deputy, Dr. Dryden. The gifted scientists, engineers, and technicians who splendidly served the Army are now eagerly developing for this new organization the gigantic launch vehicle, Saturn. No doubt this mighty rocket system makes its presence known loudly, possibly too loudly in Huntsville. But it is a significant forward step in our conquest of space and for growth in human comprehension. Already we have improved our understanding of matter, energy, motion, and life processes through our early efforts in space. The characteristics of the radiation belts girdling the Earth, the true nature of our space environment, including solar storms, the appearance of the Earth's total cloud cover, the feasibility of a worldwide communication system utilizing satellites. These and other space ventures have opened new vistas of thought, of understanding, and of opportunity. These, of course, are only beginning. This past month, new milestones in space exploration have been headlined throughout the world. As the months go by, we shall see many more. But marvel as we will at these technical achievements, we must not overlook this truth. All that we have already accomplished, and all in the future that we shall achieve, is the outgrowth not of a soulless, barren technology, nor of a grasping state imperialism. Rather, it is the product of unrestrained human talent and energy, restlessly probing for the betterment of humanity. We are propelled in these efforts by ingenuity and industry, by courage to overcome disappointment and failure, by free-ranging imagination, by insistence upon excellence, with none of this imposed by fiat, none of it ordered by a domineering bureaucracy. In this fact is proof again that hard work, toughness of spirit, and self-reliant enterprise are not mere catchwords in an era dead and gone. They remain the imperative for the fulfillment of America's dream. not push buttons, nor electronic devices, but superlative human qualities have brought success and fame to this place. These qualities I mention because they typify a distinguished American, George Catlett Marshall, in whose name we carry forward this activity. General Marshall was supremely endowed. He was a man of war, yet a builder of peace. Forceful and dynamic as a leader, calculating and prudent in judgment, yet warmly regarded by his associates. He was selfless, indeed facing, yet known and admired throughout the world. Though dominating in personal force, in action and thought, he was humble and considerate. Northern born and Southern schooled, all-American through military service, he ultimately became a citizen of the world. I, of course, knew him best during the prosecution of World War II. I found him immune to discouragement, relentless in carrying the war to the enemy, and unsparing of himself in his leadership of the great forces he directed. But so profound was his devotion to the constructive works of peace, so outspokenly was he their advocate as Secretary of State, that he later became the symbol of renewed hope for scores of millions of suffering people throughout, through his great plan for Europe that will forever bear his name. He became, in consequence, the only professional soldier ever to be honored with the Nobel Peace Prize. During his final 20 years he lived with, he counseled and influenced the greatest men and movements of his time. Through it all, he remained unaffected, reserved, completely disinterested in himself, and dedicated to our nation's highest ideals. We, participating in this brief ceremony, agree with Sir Winston Churchill, who said that succeeding generations must not be allowed to forget General Marshall's achievements and his example. There are ways to do this that General Marshall would have prized far more than what we do here today. It is not enough that we rest with praise of his name, but we can, newly resolved to work ceaselessly with all our hearts and with such talents as we may possess, as he did throughout his life, for the good of this land and its freedoms. Thus we shall carry forward the noble mission of our republic, ever striving to strengthen peace, ever advancing the cause of human liberty, ever doing our best to build a better life for all. That is what George Marshall would wish from us today. In this spirit, and with deep satisfaction in having shared, in this tribute to a revered friend, I dedicate this to the George C. Marshall Space Flight Center. May this great center be ever worthy of its honored name. Now, Governor Patterson and friends, I have an additional comment that is especially meaningful to me. With us is Catherine Marshall, General Marshall's constant helpmeet during the world events of which I've spoken. Without her inspiration, loyal support, and companionship, the great American whom we honor here today could not have hoped to achieve the height I have briefly outlined. I salute this distinguished lady. I am, with all of you, delighted that she could be with us today as we permanently enshrine a bust of her husband, which will serve as an inspiration to all who work and visit here. Mrs. Marshall, I would be deeply grateful if you would step forward with me and unveil this sculpture of General George C. Marshall.
Thank you.
Well, we can get my documents out of here.
I should like now to introduce the Reverend George Hart, pastor of the St. Mark Lutheran Church of Huntsville, who will give the benediction.
Let us pray. O God, the author and finisher of our faith, continue to abide with our nation and people, and cause us to be faithful to our God-given destiny. Bless, we pray thee, our president, and all those who have made our nation strong. And we humbly pray that this installation dedicated to the honor of the great American General George Marshall may always be faithful in its calling and to continue to open the doors of knowledge in thy universe. But especially do we pray that peace, thy peace, may become a reality in our time as we work and live to thy glory and for the well-being of mankind and not for ourselves. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, our national anthem.
Of the official ceremonies, the president is escorted by Dr. Von Braun through several of the Marshall Center's major facilities. The first facility visited by the presidential party is the Fabrication and Assembly Engineering Division. In this division, NASA prototype super boosters and space vehicles are produced and fabricated. In the background is the Saturn booster, which is presently being assembled in the fabrication division. The Saturn has the objective of lifting multi-ton payloads into orbit around the Earth and into deep space. A 1/10 scale engineering model of the three-stage Saturn vehicle is described to the president by Dr. Glennon and Dr. Von Braun. The Saturn development is the responsibility of the George C. Marshall Space Flight Center. The super booster first stage, with 1,500,000 pounds of thrust, has been successfully captive fired several times. The long-range Saturn program calls for several possible configurations. The first configuration will consist of the booster unit, made up of 8 conventional liquid-fueled rocket engines, each developing 188,000 pounds of thrust, or an overall thrust of 1,500,000 pounds. The second stage will be powered by 4 17,500-pound thrust liquid hydrogen engines. The third stage will have 2 engines identical with those in the second stage. For satellite missions, this configuration will orbit payloads of about 20,000 pounds. Later configurations employing the same booster will have the capability of orbiting 45,000 pounds, or transporting a manned vehicle around the moon and back to Earth, or placing instruments on Mars or Venus. President Eisenhower inspects the huge Saturn booster. The booster is 22 feet in diameter and 80 feet in length. After leaving the fabrication division, the president and his party proceed to the Marshall Center's test division. The test division performs experimental and developmental testing of super boosters and complete rocket systems and their components. This testing, including static firings, is conducted at the test area. While in the test area, the president will be shown another Saturn booster installed in the captive test stand. The president demonstrates that he is no exception to safety regulations by wearing the required hard hat, a protective helmet. The president and other guests proceed to the lower level of the captive test stand. Here they are shown the huge blast deflector, which during an actual static firing of the Saturn booster, diverts the flame from the base of the test stand. Above them towers the 80-foot-tall Saturn booster. President Eisenhower is shown a photograph taken during the actual test of the Saturn booster. During this test firing, all 8 engines of the booster were operating. After observing the booster from a lower level, the party is taken by elevator to the third level of the 177-foot-tall test stand. Here, the president inspects the 8 H1 engines which power the Saturn booster. At the completion of his inspection, the president joins other members of the official party as they pose for photographers from the press, TV, and wire services. Dr. Glennon joins President Eisenhower for the trip back to Redstone Airfield. The president's trip to the Marshall Center establishes a precedent for Huntsville and the Marshall Center. This is the first time a chief executive has visited this area. The George C. Marshall Space Flight Center was brought into existence at the direction of President Eisenhower and has been formally dedicated by him. The future role of the George C. Marshall Space Flight Center, judging by the presence of the many honored guests on this day, looms significantly in the expectations of the American people. At the airfield, the president hurries to a nearby car and pays his respects to Mrs. Marshall before boarding the Columbine for the return flight to Washington. It has been less than 2 hours since the president's arrival, but it has been a memorable 2 hours for officials and employees of the Marshall Space Flight Center. Dr. Von Braun, Dr. Glennon, and other officials are on hand to see the president off. At 12:10 p.m., September 8, 1960, the presidential aircraft starts down the runway, bringing to a close the dedication ceremonies at the George C. Marshall Space Flight Center.